So let's talk about large language models, because that's what we're interested in. That's the generative AI that we're really interested in. How do you make one? Well, you start with a neural network. What's a neural network? Here's a picture of one. You start with numbers on the left, which are the inputs, and these numbers are really encoding for all kinds of different things. It could be a picture, could be music. In our case, what we're really talking about is it's text, right? You take text, you encode it into numbers, and then you push it through these knobs. And what are these knobs? Well, these are really called parameters or weights. I call them knobs because you can adjust them. And that's how you train this neural network, is by tweaking these knobs. These knobs are really similar, when you think about tweaking them, to tuning a radio station, right? Which has one knob, the tuning knob. And you start with noise and you get it kind of close to the station and you can kind of hear it dialing in. And then you tweak it, you listen, and then you tweak it a little more and it sounds better. And you listen, you tweak a little more, over you overshot, you come back. That's how these things are trained too. You start with numbers on the left, you push it through these knobs, which is basically math, lots and lots of math, and you get numbers on the right. You look at the numbers on the right. Is that really what you expected? No, if it's not, then you tweak the knobs and you do it again. And you keep doing that and tweaking the knobs until the numbers on the right are exactly what you expected, and then you've got a trained neural network. So that's what you start with. And then what do you add? You add some video cards. All right, so back in 83, this was Donkey Kong. 2023, 43 years later, same video game. Very different look. How did we get there? Well, the invention of video cards. In 96 was the first 3D graphics card at 350,000 triangles per second. That's TPS. You can find these numbers in the TPS report. In 2023, we have modern GPUs that have thousands of cores and can do several billions of triangles per second. And how do they do these triangles per second? Math. Everything that's required to render this 2023 picture of Donkey Kong, which is all of the lighting and the shading and the 3D effects and all the surfaces and everything else, it's all math. And coincidentally, it's the same math that's required to generate those neural networks that we talked about on the previous page. So you got the idea of a neural network, and then you feed it these really, really capable hardware things, which were driven by the gaming industry, which is a huge industry. And at some point, some smart data scientist said, hey, I can use these video cards to process my neural networks, and voila, AI was transformed. So started with neural networks, added in some video card hardware, and then you tried it on language. So in 2013 was the first successful neural network language model that was done by Google. Revolutionized the space because it had been tried before, but it was too hard. Language was too hard because there's so much nuances to it. There's so many rules, there's so much meaning, et cetera. We didn't have enough capability, but once video cards came along, we started using those for neural networks. Google was able to successfully do it. They did it in 2013. In 2017, 4 years later, they invented the transformer architecture, which was another sea change in the industry. That very next year, they released their first transformer-based neural language model, which is called BERT. You can see BERT in the upper left-hand corner of this picture here. It's still around, still in use in lots of places today. Right on the heels of BERT, a company called OpenAI, which at that time was a nonprofit organization, released their first transformer-based language model called GPT-1. You can see it in there too. By the way, this picture, what's represented on this picture is how many knobs, weights, parameters, whatever you want to call them, are in these language models. And you can see BERT and GPT-1, they're just little specks compared to what we have today. The ones that are we have today, which are is only 5 years later, are enormous. So from 2018 with GPT-1 to 2022 with GPT 3.5, that's only two generations. Each of those generations of GPT was 100 times bigger than the previous one. That's what ChatGPT is based on. You can see GPT 3, that generation on the left-hand corner of the picture. That's how big it is, and that's the thing that really took the world by storm. That's the thing that caused the newspaper articles. That's the thing that got everybody's attention until the granddaddy, really, of large language models came out just last month, actually a month and a half ago now, GPT-4, the next generation of GPT. This is the one that not only did it spawn newspaper articles, it spawned an open letter by really important academics and technology people that said, stop. You've gone too far. This is enough. We need to take a break. Do we really need to? I don't know. But that's what happened. That's how much splash this thing made. It is nominally 100 times more powerful. well, more knobs, not necessarily more power, but 100 times more knobs than GPT-3. We don't know because OpenAI hasn't told us, but what they have told us is that it's 40% more likely to produce factual responses than ChatGPT, which makes us go, how many non-factual responses does ChatGPT reproduce that GPT-4 could be 40% better? That makes you scratch your head. But in any case, the picture on the right is kind of fun. This is exam scores from GPT-4. Both ChatGPT, which is 3.5 in blue, and GPT-4, which is in green. The one I've circled there is the bar exam. Your next attorney is probably not GPT-4, but what probably is true is that GPT-4 did better on the bar exam than your next attorney because it scored in the 90th percentile, which means it scored better than 90% of the attorneys out there. So that's how you, what I missed on this slide is the idea of let it read the internet. This thing is trained on the entire internet. And so it knows really everything that's on the internet and it can respond like a human. As I said before, you have to take it with a grain of salt. You know, the old adage of don't believe everything you read on the internet is now kind of like, don't believe everything that a chatbot read on the internet and is convincing you is true in a very convincing manner. So what about large language models for HS classification? Well, I give it a try. Let's just ask it, hey, GPT-4, what's the HS classification of a can of chicken soup? It starts with, hey, I'm not a customs expert, and a lot of disclaimer, and then it goes on to say, you might want to start in chapter 16. Well, I'm not a customs expert either, but I'm pretty sure that a can of soup is in chapter 21, specifically 2104, 1060, like there. So what I would recommend you do is the last thing that GPT-4 told me, which is consult a customs broker. But where large language models do work well for classification is take the input that you give it, can of chicken soup, find all the relevant sources and serve them up to you at your fingertips. Use those relevant sources to guide me to what the correct code is. You could argue that that's what it was doing. It was wrong. And let the user, the expert, decide what's completely out to lunch in the information that it's giving me. So not the picture on the left here, which is a robot taking over your job, but the picture on your right here, a tool that you can use to do HS classification. How do I know that this works well? Because I built one of these things. It's called Quickcode. Here's my shameless Quickcode plug. What does Quickcode do? It provides quick and accurate HS classification to experts. It incorporates state-of-the-art language models, the ones that we just talked about. It's a human-in-the-loop HS classification system, which means it doesn't do the classification for you. It uses those language models and that AI to consult all of the references and serve those references to you at your fingertips and to guide you using those references to the right classification. And most importantly, it'll help you do it in 60 seconds. It helps you walk through kind of the same processes that you already do as an HS classifier, which is look at the schedule, look at the notes, look at the rulings, look at the WCO explanatory notes, synthesize all that information based on the thing that you're trying to classify, and then come up with the right classification. It helps you do that same process that would have taken you tens of minutes, hours before, and get it done in 60 seconds. I hope you'll give us a try. You can sign up for our beta. We're not live yet. We are selling starting next month, but we're in beta. Everybody can use it. Just go to that link, put in that code, which if you're wondering is a cold water shrimp with a shell on. You can register with that code and try out our beta. What's our takeaway? Number one, AI is not going away and is getting drastically better and more ubiquitous every single year or every single month, it seems like. The best AI tools out there let humans do what they're good at, which is understand the nuance of things like HS classifications, and let the AI do what it's good at, which is synthesizing large amounts of data and serving them up to you. And then the last thing is HS classifiers are not going to be replaced by AI, but they are going to be replaced by HS classifiers who use AI. That's it. I think we'll take some questions now. Hopefully there are some.